Okay, great. I want to share just a little 2 or 3 minute devotional called Bouncing Back that I put on Facebook today, and it's got a whole lot of response. And this really came out of last Tuesday night's live stream when we were talking about Anne and her Judson and her husband, Adoniram, and Richard's going to have to help me with this pronunciation. But anyway, I came up with a word that I felt described Anne Judson, and it was resilient. And resilience is the ability to bounce back. And we all need to bounce back because we all encounter setbacks from which we must bounce back in life. And I just posted about Paul on his first missionary journey. He had at least four. And on his first missionary journey in a city called Lystra, the people decided that they did not like him. And so they stoned him until he was lying unconscious, not moving. And supposing him to be dead, they drug him out of the city and left him lying there. And as far as they were concerned, they had put an end to this Paul. But the Bible says that some of the disciples came. Disciples are committed followers. Some of the disciples came. You know, you can count on disciples. The disciples came, and Paul, we were talking about this in the prayer room, our friend Paul down in Manville was saying that he preached about being disciples of Jesus. Well, the disciples came and they stood around Paul, and he apparently God's healing power was released. And it says Paul rose up and went back into the city. The people must have been shocked that thought they had put an end to Paul. But Paul bounced back. And it was important that he bounced back because the most important aspects of his life was still in the future. He would yet go to places like Philippi, Thessalonica, Corinth, Ephesus, and Rome, where he would do some of his most strategic and world-changing ministry. And so Paul's future was still ahead of him. And I want you to know that you have a future in front of you, and that is why you too must bounce back from whatever setback you may have encountered. Hallelujah. And you can bounce back just like Paul did. Praise the Lord. Sue, I'm going to throw the ball over to you.
Okay, that's good, Eddie. We all need that reminder, don't we? This lesson tonight is on women in the 1800s in the healing revival, and we're dealing with how the Holy Spirit, when He is restoring, it's been a gradual restoration of truth, He restores the truth of the gospel. And at this time, He was restoring a number of things, including the truth about healing. You know, Eddie, up to this time, and I'm hearing myself and it's bothering me, so I'm going to take these off.
Okay.
Up to this time, people didn't really understand that it was the character of God to heal them. Mm-hmm. They believed that suffering was a sign of spirituality, and some people even prayed to suffer more because it was a badge of spirituality.
And some of the Catholic mystics and monks, they inflicted suffering upon themselves.
Yeah,
oh, okay. Yeah.
No. I don't know if this is going to work or not.
Yeah.
But if we want to interact, I think I need to keep both screens up.
Can you put yourself in the bigger screen since you're going to do most of the talking
now?
Okay.
No, can't do
okay.
it. Can't do it. Not tonight. It
okay.
means doing a whole lot of things that
there are ways to do it, folks. We're still learning how all that this technology that we have will do.
So,
I was just saying, Sue, commenting on what you said, that many of the medieval Catholic mystics and monks inflicted suffering upon themselves because they thought the more that they physically suffered, the closer they would get to God.
So it was very important then at this period in the restoration of the gospel that eyes and hearts opened up to the reality that it's the character of God to heal, not to cause suffering. So anyway, we're entering into this part of the progress toward restoration.
And can I just give one, you don't have to put it on me. Can I just give one example of this? I wrote about this, and it's in an article on our blog about, I think, about mysticism. But there was one, and he was, I don't doubt that he was a godly person and that he loved God and he wanted to be close to God. But my friends, you can be sincere in your heart, but wrong in your thinking. And in trying to be closer to God and thinking that suffering in itself would add value to his spirituality, he made a cloth and he put nails in it, and he wore this garment with these spikes and nails in it that punctured his body until the blood ran down to his feet and on the ground. And he thought that that was making him more spiritual and more holy and closer to God. So, you know, this was something that really needed to be dealt with.
Okay.
And so then people begin to value sickness and thinking, well, if that's the case, then sickness will help me to get closer to God. Now, there are people, it's not the suffering or the sickness itself, it's how we respond to it.
But so, God doesn't put sickness on us.
Right, yes.
But because we live in a fallen world.
We live in an imperfect fallen world.
There are things like in our health that we have to bounce back from.
We have to deal with.
Times.
We have to bounce back from. We have
and
to deal with.
Right. And
not only in faith, but in some natural ways too, that we have learned that we've had to deal with, not only in faith and God's word, but with looking after ourselves and with diet, exercise, proper rest, and so on.
Okay, let me get through this part, and then let's see how it unfolds,
sure.
Okay?
Yeah.
So in this course, we looked at the 10 things Jesus taught about women, and in capsule form, they are, he taught that women and men are equal in substance and value, in privilege and responsibility, in function except for childbearing, of course, and authority. No other religion in the world teaches that equality. Creation teaches this, that Jesus taught, and Paul taught this as well. And the Holy Spirit has continued through the centuries to demonstrate this. We've also discovered in this course how it was that the message of Jesus and the Bible were corrupted, and the church plunged into darkness from about the year 325 until about 1517. With this fall of the church, with this plunging of the church away from what Jesus had demonstrated to a human form of control and religion, women were once again suppressed. But beginning in the early 1500s, a new day dawned when the Bible became accessible. Notice that when the Bible became accessible, up to that point, people were seeking experience. Soul realm experience and what they thought would be spiritual experience, but they were using methods that had come in from Eastern religion. But once the Bible came back, once the Bible was made available, many were able to see, well, those things we've been doing, those methods, that's not what Jesus did. That doesn't represent what Paul did. That's not even in the Old Testament. So as they got more educated in what the Bible said, the Holy Spirit was able to get a grip on people, and the Holy Spirit began to restore the message of Jesus. Now, it was a long and arduous process. Prior to this time, this around 1517 with Martin Luther and the Reformers, prior to this time, with the fall of the church, the corruption of the message meant that women were seen as wombs and workers, that is, those who served while men were expected to rule by virtue of their gender. But through the written word of God, the Holy Spirit had a solid means of gripping hearts and minds. Through willing ones, both men and women equally, the kingdom, that is, the culture of heaven, found various degrees of expression within the culture of earth. We call it Christianity. We call it revival when it's amplified, when it's intensified. It's the inbreaking of the culture of heaven. It's not a party. It's the inbreaking of the culture of heaven through the power of the Holy Spirit. Even as we had seen the values of the culture of heaven in Jesus, demonstrated in Jesus, we began to see those same things in those who were His, those who were willing and obedient. We observed, the word is observed, during the centuries of reform and restoration, whenever a significant outpouring of the Holy Spirit occurred, the same things began to happen that happened in the Gospels. Did Jesus heal in the Gospels? Well, when the Holy Spirit comes on the scene, guess what? Healing happens. And the book, this happened in the Gospels and the book of Acts. People like Saul became Paul, a whole new creation in Christ Jesus. Evangelism exploded. Bible teaching was popular. Healing from heaven happened. And women were lifted by the Spirit out of secondary social status toward equality to the extent that the prevailing culture would allow. And now this brings us to the current study of women in the healing movement of the 1800s, especially in the United States, where there had developed a unique cultural environment that facilitated this progress. In this movement, as expected, we see the progress of the restoration of the equality Jesus taught. Now, in the previous two lessons, we noted how the progress of restoration of the gospel message produced a new surge of world missions. And in this movement, we saw how God used women equally with men, and sometimes alone and apart from male colleagues. God increased the volume of woman's voice. Now, in this lesson, we want to see how another part of the gospel, the divine healing component, was restored during this same period. We know that in the Old Testament, God revealed Himself as the Lord our healer. Okay, we see it in Exodus 15, 26, for example. That is to say, and this is important, it is God's character and nature to heal. God is the healer. That is His nature. That is His character. That can give us confidence from the word go. God's nature. He revealed Himself by the name Jehovah Rapha, the Lord our healer. Now, in the New Testament, Jesus, who is God with us, right? God with us demonstrated God's healing. He went about doing good, the Bible tells us, and healing. In fact, Eddie, what is it, about 75% of His earthly ministry?
Yes, yeah, most of His earthly ministry was taken up with healing.
Isn't that interesting? He was demonstrating.
He was moved with compassion.
That's it. It wasn't a legalism and a do this, this, and this. There were not three steps to healing. There were not seven steps to healing.
It flowed out of compassion.
It flowed out of the compassion of the Holy Spirit.
And there must be
that
compassion
shed abroad in the hearts, in His heart and the hearts of those who are willing to do that, to allow that compassion to flow. Because it's the nature of God. God is love. It's the nature of God to heal, whether it was in the Old Testament, whether it was when Jesus visited the earth, or whether it's by the Holy Spirit present in those who believe and understand that when that compassion is flowing and when there are manifestations, expressions of the Holy Spirit, then this is God reaching down into our environment to heal. Isn't that powerful, Eddie?
It's
that simple. And yet for centuries, the church during the Dark Ages had lost this simple, powerful, essential truth. Wow. So, Jesus went about doing good and healing, and the Holy Spirit continues to demonstrate that healing character, that heart of God, that power today. Creator, Savior, Spirit, the healer. Hand in hand with this demonstration of God's character to heal, we see a demonstration of God's character to lift women toward equality with men. Because with the Holy Spirit comes the supremacy of God's character and values over and above the fallen culture of humanity. God does not favor one gender over another. God has no favorites. Isn't that a relief? God has no favorites. Oh, if we could just stop and think about that. God has no favorites.
You're his favorite child.
And you are. And you are.
And we can say, I'm his favorite kid.
Yes, yes. He heals because it's his character to do so. He expresses himself through each of us without regard for gender. Let me say that again. He expresses himself through each of us without regard for gender, but according to his will and as we cooperate with him. So with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in the divine healing movement of the 1800s, we see a significant restoration of the equality of women. Pioneers of this movement included women leaders such as, and I need to bring up, let's see, that's on your screen, Eddie. I need to bring it up on my screen. I have pictures of these people where I could find them. Mother Ann Lee. And that funny, that's not coming through on my, from the current slide. Come on. Okay.
Got the right camera on it? You have to, maybe just, you have to just, switch cameras, do you?
Nope.
Well, something's happening.
Yep. It'll come. There it
there
is.
You, there is something.
From the current slide.
Okay.
Oh, didn't do from the current slide. Okay. Hallelujah. Okay. Let's see. As I do these, Eddie, perhaps I'll put the double screen on so people can see the larger monitor and still see me as I'm talking.
Okay.
Let's try that. Okay.
That's right. They can see that.
Right. They can see that better than they can see it on the small monitor behind me. Women in the early, let's see, leaders such as Mother Ann Lee, Ellen White, Mrs. Elizabeth Mix, leaders of later years included Carrie Judd Montgomery, Maria Woodworth Eder. And the prominence of these women and other women indicates the effectiveness of their ministries, ministries that were powerful in the spirit. Now, the Shakers were people of spirit. I don't know how many of you have heard of Shaker Furniture and the Shakers. They were started by a woman named Mother Ann Lee, who was born in Manchester, England in 1736. She migrated to the New World, where she founded the United Society of Believers in Christ's Second Appearing. I'll say that again. This was the name of her church, her organization. The United Society of Believers in Christ's Second Appearing. But they became known as Shakers. And why was that, Eddie? Why were they called Shakers? Can you tell us?
Well, I know that they experienced manifestations of the Spirit. So I'm assuming for similar reasons that the people who called themselves Friends became known as Quakers, because they sometimes, in experiencing God's presence, they shaked or quaked. So I'm guessing that it was for the same reason, because they were existed somewhat, their times overlap, that the Shakers probably were called Shakers because in their meetings they probably sometimes shook or trembled in God's
presence.
And you
know, Eddie, they didn't understand. There's a picture behind you.
Yeah, I see
it. Of some of the Shakers. They did not understand what this shaking was. They knew it was had something to do with the Holy Spirit manifesting the presence of God. But they thought that it was the Holy Spirit shaking sin out of them. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's what they thought.
That's where they got it. Okay.
Yeah, they thought it was a purging.
So they called themselves Shakers or somebody else did?
I don't know.
Usually these names are given by the opponents, like the Quakers.
Right.
That name came about by their critics and their opponents.
Okay. No, there was another woman leader of this time, Ellen Gould White. Do you see her on the screen mm-hmm. behind Eddie?
Yeah.
In the 1840s, a group known as the Adventists prayed for the sick based on biblical precedents. In other words, they saw in Scripture that what I'm saying tonight, God is a healer.
Yeah.
And the main out front person, although there were men who kind of were surrounding her, mm-hmm. the public figure, the public yeah. face, let me just come back to me on this one.
Sure. Good idea.
The public face on the Adventist movement was Ellen Gould White. 1827, she was born. She passed away in just 100 years ago today, this year, 1915. We're in 2015, so she passed away 100 years ago. And one of the interesting things about these people was that they realized that even though God healed miraculously, that they had a part to play in the state of their health. So they advocated healthful living. In 1866, Ellen White established a clinic in West Battle Creek, Michigan, staffed only by Christian doctors, where they treated the sick with a combination of diet, medicine, and faith. In 1910, she founded what is now one of the leading universities, medical schools.
And medical schools and hospitals.
Loma Linda University.
Right.
And I know when Oral Roberts University closed their medical school due to lack of funding, Oral encouraged the medical students to transfer to Loma Linda.
Mm.
And part of it was because Oral Roberts stressed the importance of the whole person, spirit,
right.
soul, and body,
right.
and that God heals all, the integrated part, the whole bag.
The whole person.
So in 1910, she founded Loma Linda University to train doctors in this approach to health and healing. Mm. Now, we could get into problems that came about in both of these movements, you know, but that would take us down rabbit trails. Right now, we just want to see that there was a sense of this restoration that God
right,
is a
yes.
healer.
Yeah.
And he used women and he used men. And I believe later in this lesson, you're going to talk to us about what A.B. Simpson
yes, yes.
and a
uh-huh.
powerful, yeah. miraculous healing that he experienced.
And,
so
and,
we'll
God's,
get to that.
God doesn't wait for perfect people to use. He uses people who make themselves available to him.
Now, I want to bring up, keep these two computers together here.
Yeah.
Eddie, we know there was a powerful black woman named Elizabeth Mix from Walcottville, Connecticut.
Right.
I couldn't find the picture of her. She's been written out of history. Mm. We've got to write her back in.
Yeah.
That's part of the mandate, write mm. God's women back into history.
Yeah.
So she was healed of tuberculosis through the ministry of a man named Ethan O. Allen. I don't know if that's Ethan Allen Furniture
He was
or not.
A Methodist.
Was he?
Yeah.
Okay. So, but he obviously preached and ministered
the healing power
of God. He
experienced the healing himself, and he began to pray for other people.
Okay. So Mrs. Elizabeth Mix became the first African-American healing evangelist.
Although most of her ministry was one-on-one.
Ah. Now, I don't even have dates for her. Isn't that amazing?
Mm.
But she lived during this period, probably, what, the early 1800s?
She's the one that was instrumental in Carrie Judd
That's
healing,
true. That's true.
Which is a very powerful testimony.
Her unique contribution to the healing revival was her admonition to the sick that after having received the prayer of faith, they were to act upon that faith regardless of feeling. In 1879 or 80, through Mrs. Mix's powerful healing ministry, Carrie Judd Montgomery, who was an invalid at the time, received complete healing and became a minister of healing herself. So Elizabeth Mix, God bless her.
Yeah.
Faith Holmes And let's see, what do we have here? Charles Cullis. I want to get to him eventually. Let's go this route. Faith homes were an important part of the 19th century healing movement. The concept began in Germany with Johann Christoph Blumhardt. He was a Lutheran minister who began seeing miraculous healings in his ministry as early as 1843. When, on the basis of Mark 16:18, he prayed for a dying girl named Katerina Ditus, she was immediately healed and a revival broke out. In 1852, however, he was forced to withdraw from the Lutheran Church because of all of this, but opened a successful healing center. He would minister to the sick by first building faith through the Word of God, and then on the basis of faith and the principles of Scripture, he would pray the prayer of faith. Now, today it's like, we hear this all over. But back in those days, this was groundbreaking, because remember, we're talking about the restoration. We're talking about progress toward the restoration of the message of Jesus, which in this lesson includes healing and the elevation of women. So even though these things that I'm saying, it's like, you mean this all started with a Lutheran in Germany? Wow, it's everywhere today. Another inspiration for healing homes came from a woman named Dorothea Trudell in Switzerland. And one of these days, we must hear from Becky Duncan in Tulsa, who is going to do an induction of Dorothea Trudell in the International Christian Women's Hall of Fame. But just briefly, let me do a little paragraph on Dorothea Trudell right now. When in the midst of a medical crisis in her village, Dorothea prayed on the basis of James 5, verses 14 and 15 for her neighbors, and they were miraculously healed. To accommodate the crowds of sick people who swarmed to the village for prayer, she opened several faith homes. So successful was this woman that she was charged with practicing the healing art without a license, the first of many others to be charged in the same way, even in the 20th century, as we'll see when we move into the 20th century in our studies. She was acquitted and her popularity increased dramatically. To accommodate those seeking healing, Dorothea began corresponding with them through letters, a pattern still followed by many ministers today. By 1887, the practice of divine healing and the concept of faith homes had become so popular, especially in America, that more than 30 such centers were in operation, and many of these were under the supervision of women. The practice of divine healing and the concept of faith homes merged with the holiness movement, which we'll talk about in a lesson or two, so that many of the healing homes were operated by holiness women. Oh, wow, I could spin off there and talk about Christine Gibson in Providence, Rhode Island, and the Duncan sisters in Rochester, New York, and Elizabeth Sisson in Chicago. Oh, just so many, Eddie, so many. The single most important figure in the healing movement was a doctor by the name of Charles Cullis. And I want you to be able to see him, so I'm going to switch to Eddie's camera.
There he is.
It's not a very clear picture, but Charles Cullis was a physician in Boston. Let me switch back to the double so that we're both
on. And by the way, he attended Phoebe Palmer's meetings in New York City.
He was able to persuade leading holiness figures, including a woman who we'll get to in another lesson, named Hannah Whittall Smith. Have you heard of the classic How to Be a Happy, what is it, a Happy Christian Life?
The Secret of a Happy Christian
the
Life.
The Secret of a Happy Christian Life by Hannah Whittall
Smith. Classic.
Classic. That full salvation included healing. Mm. Cullis had in fact received his, what they then call a sanctification experience in 1862 through Phoebe Palmer's ministry. And again, if you've been with us, you've heard us share about Phoebe Palmer, and we'll do a section on her at some point before we leave this era. This event at Phoebe Palmer's Holiness was a Tuesday meeting for the promotion of holiness that she, where she gave talks. Mm-hmm. Phoebe never preached, but she gave talks.
She really did preach.
And she started out in her parlor, her living room.
She just wouldn't admit it.
Well, we...
For reasons. She had reasons.
Yes. This event marked the beginning of a vast benevolent ministry that would characterize Cullis for the remainder of his life. And it was through reading the life of Dorothea Trudell in 1869 that he accepted. See, he accepted through this one young woman in Switzerland. He read her stuff and he accepted this truth about divine healing being a permanent aspect of biblical Christianity. You know, God gave me this little saying, just do your small part in God's big plan. Oh, we get so inspired and we get so full of self, we think we have to do it all. And it's like, no, no, no. If we'll just do our teeny weeny small part in God's big plan, he'll make sure that the whole thing opens. And here's an example. He read Dorothea Trudell's story. And I want to divert from my notes for a minute, Eddie, and read just a note about him.
Sure.
And let me switch it to me for this, my camera. Okay. In 1862, Dr. Cullis visited one of the Tuesday meetings for the promotion of holiness started by Phoebe Palmer. Cullis began to search the scriptures, and they came alive for him in a new way. Struggling with understanding, he decided, I will do forever, by God's grace, believe every word between these two lids. If this were a copy of the Bible, he said, I'm going to believe from this point on every word between this, the front cover and the back cover of Scripture. Now, he had just lost his beloved wife, and he'd been in a real slump. And he came out of it through this incredible encounter with the Holy Spirit as he was listening to little old Phoebe Palmer just talk, just give a talk. So he said, he declared, I will take every precept and promise of the Bible just as if my own name, Charles Cullis, was written on every one of them. You see that? He decided that word is going to be written to me. I'm going to put my name in every one of those passages. This is how real the Bible became to him. Cullis came into a conviction of personal justification through Christ alone, no more by works, as was common in those days. You don't get saved by works. You get saved by believing in Jesus. And then the fruits and the works follow. And this is what happened in his life. He felt, let's see, one day Cullis was reading the Bible, and when the words, these words in Mark 13:34, when he came upon these words, every man, or you could say every person, his or her work, it jumped off the page at him, and Cullis began to feel that God was calling him to open a home for incurable consumptives, tuberculosis. These were people for whom there was no hope of healing apart from divine intervention. So he took them under his wing and he opened a home where he could work the work that God had for him. This was a major step, but he felt he must act on what he was called to do. Like George Mueller, he set his heart to be utterly dependent on God for the provision for the ministry. The house opened in 1864 to care for the hopeless, the homeless, the destitute, and the dying. He soon added a second house and then two more. The sign over the door simply said, have faith in God. Wow. Now, I would love to tell you all of the wonderful things that God did through Dr. Charles Cullis, But I will restrain myself and keep this moving. Oh, by the way, he was also a tremendous hymn writer, Eddie. Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
I've learned that just today. I want to talk about A.J. Gordon. And here's something. I never knew, Eddie, what A.J. stood for. Did you? Do you know what A.J. stood for?
I think I've seen it before.
Who did we talk about last week?
Adoniram.
What's his second name?
Judson. So,
yes.
So he was named after him.
He was named after Adoniram.
Adoniram Judson.
Judson.
Really?
And that's
wow.
something. Mm. It's like, oh, wow, I've got to tell people that tonight. A.J. Gordon. He was born in 1836. Let me bring it back to me now. He was born in 1836 and died in 1895.
Was he born in Boston? Probably somewhere in that area, I'm sure.
One of these guys was born in Cambridge, Mass. I forget where the other one was
1836,
born.
1836, the Judsons would have been in Myanmar for some time. By the way, I got an email from Myanmar. Or no, it was a posting on Facebook from Myanmar. We were talking about Myanmar last week. But they would have been in Myanmar, and Anne would have been back for a visit and written extensively in the 1820s about their ministry in Myanmar. And so that must be how his parents knew about them.
Isn't that something? All the pieces fit together some way or other, don't they?
Yeah, and so make sure your piece is in the puzzle.
What do you mean by that, Eddie?
Everybody has something to contribute. Everyone has a gift. Everyone has a function. And make sure that you...
It's like a big puzzle.
Make sure you put your piece in the big puzzle.
Let there be no hole.
So there can be a completeness and a fullness.
Let there be no hole in
you
the picture.
You are needed.
Yes, 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 yes. Okay, let me keep moving because I want people to hear the testimony of A.B.
Yes.
Simpson.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. A.J. Gordon... 1836 to 1895, he was a Boston pastor of great intellectual and spiritual stature and was an ardent holiness advocate. Now that's, we'll explain that in another lesson. And he came to believe without question that God is a healing God. It's an integral part of the gospel. His classic book is called The Ministry of Healing. And he wrote it, published it in 1882, and it's still available. Dr. Gordon and his Clarendon Street Church were on the forefront of important social action, including world missions, temperance, we'll get to that another lesson, and women's rights. In 1894, he wrote a book called The Ministry of Women, which remains an important statement of the support for women. And in 1889, he founded the Boston Missionary Training School, which is now Gordon College. Now, here's an interesting little tidbit. Gordon College and Gordon Conwell Theological Seminary grew out of this man's ministry. And notice, he believed in the equality of women. He believed in divine healing. And guess who used to teach in Gordon Conwell Seminary? Dr. Kathy Krager. And there are a number of other well-known women and men who now teach in Gordon Conwell. So if you want a great course in women in the church, women in leadership, a great study in, Kathy used to teach, she used to teach one course on New Testament Greek. Her knowledge is still there. And so this is one of the gems that came out of him, Dr. A.J. Gordon, taking initiative in this beginning in this period. Now, Eddie, the next person that I have, and I don't know that I actually have a picture. I missed a picture of A.B. Simpson. How could I do that? Mm. Oh, my. I want to turn it to you.
Okay.
So that you can tell us about A.B. Simpson, who lived from 1843 to 1919. That was the year my mother was born, 1919.
Really? Okay.
And what I love about A.B. Simpson is that he was born in Prince Edward Island.
Yeah, he was. He's a Canadian.
one of the maritime provinces, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and Prince Edward Island.
Right.
And so A.B. Simpson, good old maritimer, as we're called. Okay, Eddie, I'm going to put the camera on you.
And maybe put another slide up.
I don't have one for A.B. Simpson. Okay. I just told you I was in a hurry this afternoon trying to get these done, and I missed him.
But you know, Sue, there was a stirring in my spirit when you were talking earlier, and I want to just share what was stirring in me. And it had to do with something you were saying prompted it, but it had to do with the association with compassion, with healing. In the Gospels, we see again and again how that healing is associated with compassion. Matthew 14:14 says that Jesus went out and he saw a great multitude, and it says, and he was moved with compassion when he saw them like sheep scattered without a shepherd. He was moved with compassion and he healed their sick. He was moved with compassion and he healed their sick. Were you going to say something?
Yeah, I do want to.
Okay, sure.
Just let me give this introduction to him, okay?
Okay.
And then maybe you could launch into his healing, which I believe is going to ignite faith in our hearts.
Yes, absolutely.
So he was Presbyterian, and he founded the Christian and Missionary Alliance Organization Church in 1887. Having been miraculously healed in 1881 through the ministry of Charles Cullis, whom we've just talked about, Simpson became a strong advocate of divine healing. But Simpson was also a woman's advocate, and this is why I wanted to get this in before you tell us his healing testimony.
Sure.
And he facilitated the ministry of many spirit-led women. Simpson expressed astounding insights related to the woman question, Eddie. For example, concerning the nature of God, I think you'll like this, he rejected the idea that God is male. Well, we, you know, those who've been with
God is spirit. He transcends.
He's spirit. He transcends gender.
We were created in his image and likeness.
And
we are not to turn around and create him in ours.
Say it again. Say it again.
God transcends everything of this earth. God is spirit, Jesus said. And God created us, male and female, in his image. And what we must not do is turn around then and try to create him in our image.
But
the church has done that throughout history.
Yes, yes. So he rejected the idea that God is male. He said that God is neither male nor female, but that God does exhibit characteristics that we understand as masculine and feminine. That's a good way of saying it. For example, in one of his books, Simpson discusses the motherhood of God. He writes, "The heart of Christ is not only the heart of man, but has in it all the tenderness and gentleness of women." In one place, he speaks in picture form, metaphorically, of the Holy Spirit as our Heavenly Mother, noting that the Comforter, now this, I'm not advocating this, I'm telling you the extent to which A.B. Simpson honored women. And this was, I mean, this must have made a lot of people really, really mad. He is talking about the Holy Spirit as the Comforter. And he says that the Holy Spirit, as a mother figure, is the Comforter, assuming our nurture, training, teaching, and the whole direction of our life. Interesting statement. Simpson facilitated women in both the educational venues and the ministerial arenas. He established the Coeducational Missionary Training College, now called Nyack College, in Nyack, New York, just up the river, up the Hudson from New York City. Several of the strong, spirit-led, spirit-filled women of God who worked with Simpson became the founders. Now get this, I have a whole study on this that I did when I was in seminary. My study is called Women Who Led the Way, 100-page, what did they used to call it, Eddie, when you do a study? A directed study. And the dean of the seminary said, oh, this needs to be published. Well, it's still on the shelf, but it does need to be published, and it's inspired many who've read it. Women Who Led the Way, you named it. You named the paper. But what happened was many of the women that he trained in his Nyack College became the women, the people who founded the Bible colleges of the early 20th century. It was not men who founded the Bible schools, it was women who founded the Bible schools. And many of them, if not all of them, were a product of A.B. Simpson's facilitating, okay? So, Eddie, A.B. Simpson has a wonderful healing testimony, and I am through with what I want to say tonight, except one small paragraph. There was a minister in this era, Seth Cook Reese, who was founder of what was called the Pilgrim Holiness Church. And speaking in 1897, he said something that's very significant. And as we transition now to a healing testimony, I want to just kind of drive the nail into this fact of God was restoring, together with the principle of healing, the elevation of women, the equality of women. And here's what Seth Cook Reese said: "Nothing but jealousy, prejudice, bigotry, and a stingy love for bossing in men have prevented women's public recognition by the church. No church that is acquainted with the Holy Spirit will object to the public ministry of women." Amen. Okay, Eddie.
Okay, so that's really great. Thank you. That's been really good. You know, A.B. Simpson was a Presbyterian. And as we've talked about before this healing movement, belief in healing was very rare in the church. And so there was this whole movement, obviously a work of the Holy Spirit, to bring this back to the attention of the church. And A.B. Simpson, his approach was what I would call, and is the right approach, a relational approach to healing, as opposed to a mechanical or formulaic approach, a relational approach where Jesus is at the center. And he was a weak and sickly person, even as a youth, and he talks about having breakdowns. And after he felt he was called to the ministry, and even when he was preparing for the ministry, he was struggling with his health. And then after he went into the ministry and had been in the ministry a few years, always struggling with his health, a physician, and at another point had a breakdown, a physician friend called him aside and advised him that he needed to leave off everything that was stressful in life, including his ministry, if he wanted to live more than just a few months, because he was so weak and sickly. And so he was looking for help, and he heard about some of these people who were emphasizing that it is God's will to heal today. And so he went to one of Charles Cullis's faith conventions at Old Orchard Beach, Maine. And we've driven through Old Orchard Beach, Maine, and I'm sure probably Richard has been there and maybe some others up there in the Northeast. But Charles Cullis used to hold yearly faith conventions where they were emphasizing faith and healing. And he went to one of those and more than one, and he was listening and receiving. He didn't receive it at first, but he kept listening. And finally, he came to the conclusion that he believed it was the truth. But then he felt he had to make a commitment to it. And he tells about how, and this was a very solemn thing to him. He stood before God, just him and God, and he made this very profound commitment. And, here it is right here. And he said to God, he said, "As I shall meet you in that day, I solemnly accept this truth." What is this truth? This truth of divine healing, God's will to heal, "as part of thy word." Now, he's saying this when he's in this very
physically weak and sickly state and has been advised to leave the ministry and to get away from anything that puts any kind of stress on his constitution if he wants to live more than a few months. So this is the situation he's in. And so, but he's seeing the truth of it, but now he has to embrace it. And so he stood before God and he said, as I shall meet thee in that day, I solemnly accept this truth as part of thy word and of the gospel of Christ, and God helping me, I shall never question it until I meet thee there. Secondly, that was the first one. Secondly, he said, as I shall meet thee in that day, I take the Lord Jesus as my physical life for all the needs of my body. And thirdly, he says, as I shall meet thee in that day, I solemnly agree to use this blessing for the glory of God and the good of others. In other words, this is not a selfish thing. He's not wanting to be a great healing evangelist or something. He's wanting to be well himself, of course, but he's saying to God, I will never use this selfishly. I will always use it for your honor, for your glory, and for the good and for the help of others. Now, that's a good attitude to have. So, a few days later, now he didn't really experience any difference, but now he has made a commitment. And a few days later, he was preaching Sunday morning and Sunday night at a church. And he felt in his heart that God wanted him to give this testimony about Jesus being the healer and about this commitment he had made. But in fear, he drew back and he didn't do it. Well, Sunday night came and he knew if he was going to be obedient. My friends, through faith and obedience, through faith and patience, faith and obedience, the miracles will come. And so somewhat reluctantly, Sunday night, he began to share his testimony and how he believed that God had revealed to him that he was the healer and this commitment he had made to this truth. And he said he felt like it was probably more for him than anybody else, but he was coming out in the open with this. Now, something happened he had not anticipated. There was a small group of men there invited him. There was a nearby mountain, and they had already planned this. They were going to climb this 3,000-foot mountain, and so they invited him to go along. Well, he's just given this testimony how he's taken Jesus as his healer. Now, this was a little challenging to his faith. And he says here, and this is true, he says, I do not recommend anybody just to go out and do something to show how strong you are or to just go out to try to show your faith. No, that can be an act of presumption. But in his situation, he knew he had to do it as an act of faith in obedience to God. You see, this is a personal thing. You know, here's the thing. Let me say this. We can be inspired by other people's testimony, but it has to become a personal thing between you and the Lord. So he sensed in his heart that he had to do this. And so he went with this small group of men and they began climbing this mountain. And it wasn't before long, he said, like he felt he was on the edge of taking his last breath. He said all of his old weaknesses and frailties and seemed to be there, and he felt he could collapse at any moment. He said, but then he sensed this other presence there, this presence of strength there also, and he had to reach out and begin to lean on it. And he said as he was climbing the mountain, it was like the way he described it, the shepherd was on one side and the wolf on the other, and he had to choose. He had to draw on and grasp and embrace the shepherd, embrace Jesus, embrace the healer. And he continued. And as he did this, he said he felt strength. He felt vitality and he felt life. And he said, by the time I got to the top of the mountain, he said, I felt the heavens were open and all of my weaknesses and sicknesses had crumbled to the ground. And he said, from that day to this, he said, I have had a new heart, both spiritually and physically. Now, here is something else, though, that he talked about and he shared, that he felt God showed this to him, because it wasn't like there was none of the old weaknesses that were there. They were still there. But he said, this is what God showed him. I'm not going to give you like a healing such that you can live in it and you don't need me. He said, God showed him, you're going to have to draw on me every day. You're going to have to walk in my life and my health in every day. I'm not going to fix you up and do something in you that you can go off and run on your own and that you don't need me. No, the Lord showed him, you're going to have to walk every day with me. Trust me every day. Look to me every day. Draw on my life. Draw on my strength. Draw on my healing every day. And so he learned to relate to Jesus as his healer. And this is one thing he emphasizes, is not receiving healing as something apart from Jesus, but receiving Jesus as your healer and living in him and walking in his life and his healing and his strength every day. And he wrote a little poem and in which he tried to emphasize this. But I think maybe what I would like to do is just read the first paragraph of a message that he preached on this topic of Jesus, the healer. He called it himself. And he loved the scriptures such as Matthew 8:17. It says, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. And in this message called himself, he said, I wish to speak to you about Jesus and Jesus only. I often hear people say, I wish I could get hold of divine healing. And he would emphasize, it's not divine healing you need to get a hold of. You need to get a hold of Jesus himself. Sometimes they say, I have got it. If I ask them, what have you got? The answer is sometimes, I have got the blessing. Sometimes it is, I have got the theory. Sometimes it is, I have got the healing. Sometimes they say, I have got the sanctification. But I thank God we have been taught that it is not the blessing, it is not the healing, it is not the sanctification, it is not the thing, it is not the it that you want, but it is something better. It is the Lord himself, it is Christ himself that we want and that we must have. And everything else flows out of that. And then the little poem that he wrote, the first paragraph says, once, and oh, may we all come to this place. This is a picture of growth in grace, where Christ becomes our all in all. He says, once it was the blessing, now it is the Lord. Once it was the feeling, now it is his word. Once his gifts I wanted, now the giver on. Once I sought for healing, now himself alone. When we get Jesus, oh, we get the full package, my friends. And then there are several verses here, but I want to read just one more. Once it was my working, his it hence shall be. Once I tried to use him, now he uses me. Once the power I wanted, now the mighty one. Once for self I labored, now for him alone. My friends, this is what I call the relational approach to divine healing. It's not a doctrine that heals us. It's not a formula that heals us. It's not a method that heals us. It is the living, risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who is still, who is yet moved with compassion, moved by the feelings of our infirmities, and who wants to reach out to a sick and broken humanity with compassion through His body, which is you and I. And as Sue was sharing earlier, in the 19th century, God, by the Holy Spirit, began a movement of healing, seeking to restore this idea, this truth, back to His church, that He is a healing Jesus. He is the healing Lord, that He is the fulfillment of Yahweh Rophe, the Lord our physician, the Lord our healer. Hallelujah. And I believe with all my heart that He has a healing way for you. Yes, sometimes God heals instantaneously, miraculously, and those get printed up. Those make the testimonials. And sometimes the problem is that we think that those are the norm. No, those are not the norm. Those are the exceptions. I heard Oral Roberts himself say, I used to teach at Oral Roberts University, and I heard Oral Roberts say that he estimated that only maybe 5% of the people on whom he laid hands on and prayed, only 5% were instantly healed. Does that mean it wasn't God's will to heal others? No, absolutely not. But in so many cases, it's like my situation that you've heard me share before. In 1989, when I became very ill, and I tried the formulaic approach, I confessed the scriptures. Hey, and I still do that. I believe in that. But I did all the things that, you know, that we're told to do, but nothing was happening. And one day, God, because I didn't throw in the towel, I didn't give up on the Lord, I believed in Him, I still believed in the Word, I still believed in healing, I still believed in the promises, and He began to show me the path that I would have to walk down in order to experience His healing power in my life. Started out, the first thing was, you will come out of this by reversing the process that got you into it, which meant I was going to have to change my lifestyle, how I ate, how I getting proper rest, exercise, and so on. So there had to be a change. But you see, it was a personal, it was a relational approach to healing rather than a formulaic, mechanical approach. And so maybe we could pray. I know there are people out there right now struggling with your health, and maybe struggling, maybe not just physically, but maybe mentally, emotionally. What I want you to know is that Jesus is a healer. And what A.B. Simpson did on that day, and he makes this very clear, in the same way that many years before he had accepted Jesus as the Savior of his soul, the forgiver of his sins, on that day he accepted Jesus also as his physician, as the healer of his body. And maybe that's what somebody listening to me needs to do tonight. Because you see, God wants you to know that He is Jehovah Rapha. He is the Lord, your healer. He is Jesus who heals, who still is moved with compassion and heals today. So Lord, I thank you for every person who has tuned in to us tonight. God, I thank you. I believe you have ministered hope to somebody's heart. I believe you have ministered encouragement to somebody's faith. And Lord, I pray that you will help everyone to know that you, Jesus, that you want them well, you want them strengthened, you want them whole. And as they trust in you and look to you, God, you will lead them in the way that will bring them into health and healing. And you will make them a channel and a conduit to minister your hope and your healing out to others as well, oh God. Lord, thank you for that tonight. Thank you that you're doing it. We give you all of the praise. We give you all of the glory. In Jesus' mighty name. And I'll sing a little song. I think I sang a little bit of it earlier, but it's a great song. What a healing Jesus I have found in you. Oh, My friends, look to Jesus. Embrace Him tonight like A.B. Simpson did. What a healing Jesus I have found in You. What a healing Jesus to restore, refresh, and renew. What a healing Jesus for such a time as this. Arise on healing wings, Son of Righteousness. One more time. What a healing Jesus I have found in You. Just reach out and receive from Him. What a healing Jesus to restore, refresh, and renew. What a healing Jesus. Oh, for such a time as this, arise on healing wings, Son of Righteousness. Arise on healing wings, Son of Righteousness. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, feel just a bit of a sila in my heart. Thank You, Lord. God, we thank You. I'm just going to, we'll go on and just check, Sue, if there's anything.
You know, in talking with you earlier in the day, Eddie, I said I don't want to pray Band-Aid prayers.
Oh, I absolutely.
For people. I don't want to lay heavy expectations. Are you with me?
Yeah.
I need to know if you're with
me.
Oh,
yes, yes.
Because
yeah,
I can't,
absolutely.
I don't, I need.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, there's some interaction in the prayer room about what we've been sharing, which is very good. But yeah, Sue, I want to hear, we want to hear what you're
yeah,
saying.
Yeah, stay with me for a minute.
Yeah, we want to hear
okay.
what you're saying.
I was saying that I don't want to pray Band-Aid prayers, because
mm-hmm.
prayers are not magic.
Right.
Prayers are not instruments that God's given us to have magical cures. But I know that there's a time to pray.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
To exercise authority, to take authority over
yes.
those things that are destroying people.
Mm-hmm.
Destroying their health, their
yeah.
wealth, destroying what God has given.
Right.
There's a time for us to take authority over that, you know, exercise our God-given authority and command those things to go.
Yes.
But they're not magical. That is what I was trying to get across to you
mm-hmm.
when I think it was over lunch we were talking about yeah. this. So many people look at prayer as, say a prayer for me, and it's kind of like, it's like working, I hate to use magic, but you know what I mean.
Well, the thing is, we have to be led by the Spirit in prayers.
Yeah, because there were people that Jesus...
Prayer can become religious,
there
I think that's what you're
there
saying.
There were people that Jesus passed by who needed healing,
mm-hmm.
and there were there was one story where someone was crying out to Jesus, and he said, well, what do you want?
Right.
What do you want?
Mm-hmm.
And it was obvious what he wanted, but Jesus needed for this man
to say what he needed,
what he wanted.
To be specific.
This is all about that relationship with the God who is the healer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and prayer must be relational, not just be formulaic.
Because when I see mechanical laying on of hands, or I see mechanical prayer, I just, it's like, I just want to walk away. Because it's like, God, I know that you want to help people. I know that you want to heal people.
And he can use laying on of hands in prayer.
Yes, I'm not saying those things are not.
I know what you're saying.
But it's not.
It can become a religious routine.
Yeah.
With no substance to it. Too easily.
Yeah. And another thing that I shared was so many times we go through meetings or we go to big events, or let's say people go to big events with big expectations and they leave empty. And there's something wrong with that, because when there's a connection with the Holy Spirit, we don't feel empty.
Right.
We Amen. Don't feel disappointed.
Yeah.
We don't feel like, if we feel condemned, we need to confront that and say, no, that's not of God. Condemnation is never of God. The Holy Spirit convicts us to make changes, but he doesn't condemn us and whip us, say it's all your fault, or you did this wrong, or you did that wrong, and that's why it's things are the way they are.
Right.
No, it's like he meets us where we are, and he embraces us, and he wants to direct our thoughts in the way of peace and prosperity of mind and body, spirit, soul, our whole being. He wants us to be whole.
Amen.
He wants us to be healthy.
Yeah, amen.
We are his temple. He wants to live in us.
And we can't put him in a religious box of how that will happen. It's got to be the relational thing, embracing himself and all he is into our lives.
I know you came to a point when back in 89 for that 3 years when it was really bad. I don't know how we made it. In any way, I don't know how we made it except God.
Yeah.
And I remember that, and I lost my train of thought, but I remember that, here it is. You said you started thinking about healing evangelists who were so famous and had big meetings. And some of them died young. And you had to come to a point where you said, it doesn't matter what happened to this person or that person. This is about me and God. It's between God and me.
You can't tie your faith to somebody else's experience.
Right.
And what was happening, I was reading books on faith and healing, but because I'd done a lot of research in the past, some of the very people I was reading their books on faith and healing had died early in life. And so I came to the place of God, if these people didn't make it, why should I expect that I'm going to? What right do I have? And so what you're saying is it had to come down to a place where it was himself and me, his word, his promises, and just God in me. Okay, God, I don't know why these people happened to them, but it doesn't matter. This is just between you and me.
No, all that we're saying is not to diminish the fact that there are times when God intervenes from heaven.
Absolutely.
He breaks in.
Absolutely.
And he does a miracle that cannot be explained in any natural terms.
Absolutely. Amen.
And that's important, because
that's important.
We don't want to diminish that, because, I mean,
and we want to see more of those.
And I'm thinking of people that I care about who need that today.
But I think the point we're making is we know of so many cases, being in the ministry 40 years, where people, maybe they went somewhere looking for that and it didn't happen, and they gave up. They threw in the towel. They gave up on the whole thing. No, if you don't get an instantaneous miracle, that doesn't mean that God doesn't want you well. It means you need to embrace himself and let him show you the answer for you and your situation.
Right. No condemnation.
Right.
No condemnation. Anyway.
Kathy Kosanke is blessed. She says, oh, such good words tonight. Thank you, Sue and Eddie. Oh, I want more of himself.
God bless you.
Amen. Amen, Kathy. And may God, and in the name of Jesus, Kathy, we pray with you for your family that's experiencing sickness, your son-in-law and others.
He may not want to be mentioned, Eddie, so
and we pray for God's healing presence and power through you, Kathy, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah and amen. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus.
So, just want to...
Thank you, Margaret. From Ireland, thank you, Eddie. Such a great teaching. Praise God. Amen. Amen, Margaret. God bless you. God is so good.
Yeah, and Margaret, God is so faithful. Margaret asks, why are we not seeing more healings today? I think because... Because there's this expectation. I mean, there are many reasons, and I don't have all the answers, but just off the top of my head, I think that people are led to believe that if you go to a certain minister or a certain a certain meeting, that that's where you'll get healed. No, the healing is not at a meeting. The healing is not at a person. The healing is in this awareness that God himself is Jehovah Rapha, the God, the Lord, our healer. I know that came with new emphasis as we were preparing for tonight, Eddie, that mm-hmm. in the Old Testament, I said it earlier, I'll say it again. In the Old Testament, God revealed himself as God the healer. Mm-hmm. When Jesus came, Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us.
God personified, God in the flesh.
God in the flesh, and he went about healing.
He was demonstrating God's will.
He was an expression of God with us. Mm-hmm. So, of course, and then now in this era, the Holy Spirit, we had the Creator, we have the Savior, and now we have the Spirit.
Yeah.
And the Spirit is the same. The same.
Yeah.
He is healing. That's his name.
His
Not
nature.
Just comforter, but healing. Now, why aren't we experiencing more healing today? Well, you had to go through this period where you had to change. You believed God. You had his word. We didn't have any means medically for you. We didn't have even the knowledge of nutrition and healthy living that we have today. But you, God spoke to you as you desperately sought him, mm-hmm. that you had to change your lifestyle. And healing came through your faith, through faith in the promises of God, mm-hmm. through persevering in the promises, mm-hmm. and through praising God instead of being focused on the sickness.
And obeying his instructions, just in the natural things of life.
You had to learn to eat better. You had to learn to walk. You had to learn to pull yourself away mm-hmm. from writing papers for college, for seminary at 3:00 in the morning. You had to discipline your life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I have a feeling that most people do not live that kind of disciplined life in various areas. I know our friend Barb Arbo, she and Steve have the Sanctuary, which is a prayer and teaching center in New Hampshire. And Barb has had to stand. But I remember one of her early battles was with weight. She was really, really heavy when she was a teenager. And she said that after she came to the Lord, she had to buffet her body. Now, that didn't mean, you know, hit it.
She had
to discipline her eating. She had to learn how to eat in mm-hmm. ways that were healthy.
Yeah.
I didn't know 20 years ago how to eat. I didn't know what supplements my body needed. When I think of, if I had known now about health and nutrition, what I knew if I had known it 20, 30 years ago, wow, what a difference. But I didn't. Mm-hmm. But I've had to seek God for healing. I've had to. It's that or die.
Yeah.
And I want to live and declare the works of the Lord. So I have to buffet my body.
Yeah.
I have to do these things.
You have to discipline yourself.
If I want health.
Right. My response to Margaret's question, and I'll come at it a different area. I think she might be wondering, why aren't there more instantaneous, miraculous healings? And I think a lot of those, I've learned in life, Margaret, that a lot of those will come when we're reaching out to people who are not Christians or maybe new believers, that God will do things to grab their attention, to pull them in. But I think one thing that I would mention, and I'm going to use a quote from Charles Finney about revival. I'm going to use it parallel with healings. He talked about how he had received so many requests from churches and pastors to come and conduct a revival in their city. But when he said, when I would question them of why they wanted him to come, he said, I found that their motives were an abomination to God and I wouldn't go, because he was saying how their motives were selfish. They wanted a bigger church. They wanted to be, and so on like this. And I think, going back to what I was talking about, that Jesus, his healing flowed out of compassion for the people. He wasn't wanting just to be a big famous preacher. And many people today want to have a healing ministry to make themselves more important. They want to be exalted. They want to be important. But I believe if we come to the place, the body of Christ, we're removed with compassion as Jesus was. A leper came to him and said, Lord, if you will, you can make me clean. And Jesus, the Bible says, was moved with compassion. And compassion is more than sympathy. You know, you can feel sympathy for somebody and go on your way, but compassion is something that is so deep that you feel identified with the person and you're moved to do something about it, even if it cost you something. And this is what Jesus felt also. And we see again and again in the Gospels that compassion leads to healing.
Compassion is an expression of the character of God.
Yes.
God is love. That's his name. That's his character.
And so may we be more and more moved with compassion towards the sick and the suffering.
But we can't produce that.
And as we are, well, we can make ourselves available to him.
Exactly.
You see.
Yep.
And we have to recognize where we're being selfish, where we have selfish motives, and lay our ego and our eye on the altar. And like A.B. Simpson, he said it right here in that second one that I read, Sue. He says, once it was my working, his it hence shall be. Once I tried to use him, now he uses me. Once the power I wanted, now the mighty one. Once for self I labored, now for him alone. And as we make ourselves available to him and allow his compassion to flow through us, I believe that, and we're willing to, in faith and boldness, reach out and pray and minister and speak to those who are sick and suffering, I do believe that we will see more instantaneous healings and miracles.
You know, there's a time when people are so sick that they don't have the strength themselves to believe, and that's where others can come in and hold up our hands.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking of a lady we knew many years ago in Canada. Her name was Barb. And while we were in Canada, you did a lot of teaching on this. You did a lot of sharing from the Bible about God wants you healed.
On
God
her TV program.
God wants you well.
Yeah.
Now, as the story goes, many years after we left that area, this woman became very sick and became comatose.
Yep.
They still don't know what was wrong with her, as far
in
as
intensive
I know.
Care.
For an extended period. And on one of our return visits to that city, we were having a small meeting, and she came and she said, "I've come to tonight for this one reason, and that is to tell you, Eddie Hyatt, that while I was comatose, the scriptures that I learned about God's healing power were going around and around in my mind."
She was unconscious.
Yes.
But she said, "The things you taught me and those scriptures, they were there on the inside of me." And even though outwardly I was unconscious, she said, "On the inside, I took a hold of those things you taught me." And that was what brought me through. Isn't that amazing?
So that I share that to say that was a miracle.
Yeah.
But had she become sick as she did and not had those words of scripture in her mind and heart, she probably would have died, because in her, by her own testimony, it was those scriptures. It was saying, "God, your word says, by your stripes I am healed," and so on and so forth. She said it was those things that caused healing to flow into my body, and I came out of that state, and I'm well today.
Yeah.
So I think that's very interesting, that it shows our part, the part that we individuals play. Now, I started by saying there are times when we're too sick and we have to have others of faith come along.
Yeah.
And that's where these faith homes that we shared about tonight,
right,
briefly.
They would take people at the end of themselves.
Yeah, yeah, they would take those who were dying,
who
could not care for themselves, who had no faith, and they would sit and read them scripture.
They would care for them,
feed them, have compassion for them. And many of them were healed. They were called healing homes, not homes for the sick. They were called healing
because
homes.
Because their goal was to help the people recover their health. That was the reason they brought them in.
Right.
Yoko Sue says, "Thank you very much for teaching us about A.B. Simpson's contribution for women. A.B. Simpson has been one of my favorite writers, and I truly like reading his writings."
Oh, good.
"Himself was the first writing of his I read, and since then it has been one of my favorite writings." Thank you, Yoko. And she says some other things about how she believes that outer sickness is often caused by inner problems. Well, yeah, that is so true. Even the medical profession says that some estimate as much as 75% of everyone who is in the hospital today that their illness is psychosomatic. Psychosomatic means that the physical illness has begun somewhere in the mind, like with stress, fear, etc. And did you have something there you were...
No, I think probably, though, we need to bring it to a close soon.
Thank you all for being a part. Well, thank you, Margaret. Margaret in Ireland says, "There is a real sense of God's love coming through the teaching tonight, especially at the end." Well, thank you, Margaret. You know, here's the thing. We want to help people. We don't want to just... And this is what Sue was trying to say. We don't want to just be professional preachers. We really want to share out of our experience of following the Lord these 40 plus years. We truly want to share with you what God has taught us and what we've learned. Not that we know everything, we don't. And not that we can't learn from you, we can and we want to. But we're not interested in just being a professional preachers. And this is what Sue was talking about, of not just praying religious prayers and being professional preachers. Yes, we will pray for you anytime you need prayer. We will sit with you, we'll listen to you, we'll pray with you, but we have no desire just to be a professional preacher and give you a formula and say, "Do this and send us an offering and everything will be okay." No, we truly want to help you to become all that God wants you to be and to equip you to be an effective minister for Him in your area and in your realm of life.